Thanks, guys.
Good morning. How are you? You all right? Nice to see you too. Very well.
Nice to see you. How are you?
Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you. Have a good one, too.
And you're okay.
Don't forget.
Definitely.
Be back in control.
On the right side.
It's June 2016. Boris is running the Vote Leave Brexit campaign. He doesn't think he's going to win, but even losing could help him get closer to becoming Prime Minister.
I suppose all politicians in the end are like kind of crazed wasps in a jam jar, each individually convinced that they're going to make it. You've been more or less programmed, in a way. My silicon chip, my ambition silicon chip, has been programmed to try to scrabble my way up this cursus honum, you know, this ladder of things. And so you do feel a kind of sense you got to.
Cameras, can we all take a step back, please?
Get the crowd.
I want to talk to the crowd.
Can I just talk to everybody here?
Good morning, everybody. Can you hear me?
Yeah!
Folks, this is a once-in-a-lifetime, unrepeatable opportunity for us to take back control of our country. Do you think we can do it?
Yeah!
Shall we just do one with Boris?
Meanwhile, a psychological drama is playing out inside the Johnson family. Both his brother Joe and his sister Rachel oppose Brexit and are campaigning for Remain.
I've thought about this and it's been hard for me, but I think that we are better in, you know, and I don't want to cast us adrift.
Well, it's divided us all. And it has divided the family, but mainly into members who think that Brexit is a shit idea and those who think it's a really shit idea.
Hey, what a tremendous joy it is to be here today. When I look
at his father, Stanley, now tours the country in a Remain T-shirt, campaigning against his son.
What is the word you've been hearing from the other side? Take control. Well, my message today is, yes, stay in and take control. Vote to remain. Vote to remain.
I remember Rachel Johnson once described the Brexit debate in their family as a kind of Oedipal struggle. Because, of course, Stanley Johnson had been an MEP, this staunch pro-European, great Europhile, and then Boris Johnson tried to destroy all of that and became the most high-profile figurehead for the Brexit campaign.
One member of Boris's family who plans to support him is his mother, Charlotte. She is voting Leave out of loyalty to her firstborn. Meanwhile, the Prime Minister, David Cameron, Boris's political rival, has gambled everything on winning the referendum for Remain.
Thank you. This choice about Europe, it is a choice for a generation. Do we stay in or do we go? Now, I'm very clear that the best answer is to stay in.
To help him take on the Prime Minister, Boris is joined on the Vote Leave bus by Michael Gove.
Ladies and gentlemen, friends, colleagues.
Gove was demoted by Cameron, and so, like Boris, has a motive to take on the Prime Minister.
And it's fantastic to be here with just 3 weeks to go before the referendum and the chance to take back our independence.
Gove's then-wife, Sarah, remembers him making the decision.
Michael and Boris were having lots of conversations about Brexit. And everything was so feverish. I mean, lots of people said, don't do this, because they just thought it's a massive can of worms and nothing good would ever come of it. But I think in my heart of hearts, I always knew Michael would go for Leave, just because that was politically where he always stood, really. Boris and Michael, they always just got on really quite well. And the thing is that when you are in politics, your friendships really sustain you because it's a really tough environment to be in. And I think that they were sort of on the same page politically. And of course, they were both journalists.
Thank you. Thank you.
Both Michael and Boris have that journalistic instinct for a good story, how to package an idea. I think Boris is very good at that, and so is Michael.
To fully understand the psychology of this situation, one has to go back to Oxford University, 1985. Boris Johnson, Michael Gove, and David Cameron are all studying.
Honourable members wishing to vote in favour of the motion will occupy the benches on my right. Honourable members voting against the motion will sit on the benches on my left. There being 167 votes in favour of the motion and 85 against, I declare the motion overwhelmingly carried, and I close the House at 12:18 a.m.
Boris has a clear ambition to become president of the Oxford Union, something his father attempted but never achieved. Many presidents of the Union have gone on to be prime minister.
I first met Boris at Oxford in 1983, where we were exact contemporaries. I think the first time I met him socially was at the Cheese and Wine Appreciation Society. He was this kind of biggest man on campus, the local celebrity. I was quite pleased that he remembered my name.
Chubby.
And it's all kind of big and kind of dramatic and theatrical. But after that, then he'll move on and start talking to someone else in exactly the same way and sort of, you know, work around the room, but often with a kind of phalanx, like a close protection unit, you know, around him. Almost like a politician, even back then.
Boris then joins the infamous Bullingdon Club, an all-male elite society. Draped confidently across the college steps, he wears the club's traditional outfit and once again bumps into his old Etonian pal, David Cameron. To help him become president of the union, Boris recruits a working-class student from Aberdeen, Michael Gove.
So I'm going to satisfy your right to know. I'm going to let you know what's underneath my kilt. Now, just bear with me, ladies and gentlemen. Ordinarily, people have to pay for this pleasure. And I have, underneath my kilt, a pair of Oxford Union boxer shorts.
Another member of the Boris cult, one of his kind of foot soldiers in his kind of political campaign, was Michael Gove.
Gove said his first impression of Boris was that of a basking shark waiting for students to swim towards him.
He was 2 years below Boris. Very confident, slightly odd-looking young man.
You continually want to get to the centre, the core of my private life, and you'll never get to the hard core of my private life. And I recognise the Honourable Gentleman.
And he was very articulate and quick-witted. Boris was the kind of, you know, mafia boss, and me and Gove were just members of his kind of crew, were trying to kind of marshal the votes for Boris back then. He was actually much better at it than me. He was obviously a natural politician in a way that I wasn't.
With Gove's support, Boris is victorious. Exactly 30 years later, and whilst Michael plots the Leave campaign at the back of the bus,
Boris
is once again the front man. As voting day draws closer, Remain is still predicted to win. But the polls are narrowing, and Boris is beginning to catch up with his old rival, David Cameron.
I remember him shouting at me at a birthday party. Dave said to me, you know, I am fighting for my political career here. I think that he didn't factor in the Michael-Boris combo, which was sort of explosive, really.
This whole debate is about democracy. Yeah! Our ability to speak up.
I think the real low point of the campaign for David Cameron was a Saturday afternoon where I called him up and said, tomorrow Sunday Time is going to have a letter from Boris Johnson and Michael Gove, which is basically criticising you on immigration. And I remember when I first told him that, the line went dead. And a few minutes later, he called me back and said, look, I'm really sorry. The reason I'd put the phone down was I'm just so angry that they know that I've been desperately trying to control immigration. They're questioning my integrity, and I cannot believe that two people who professed to be my friends, one of whom that was godfather to one of his children, that they were willing to go that far in order to win.
Don't go and vote on the basis of things you're being told that aren't true. So let's get out there and vote Remain tomorrow, Thursday. Go for it. Thank you.
Do you think they've won? No! Oh, they have. Can we go forward to victory on June the 23rd? Yes! Yes! Can, do we believe in this country and what it can achieve? Yes, we do, don't we?
We'll form the shame for it.
When the polls closed, I sank into a total deep depression. I don't know why. I'd been wildly optimistic the day before, but I convinced myself we were going to lose. And I was in a pretty miserable mood. I think really up until the Sunderland result. And suddenly Sunderland, I think, crikey. Wow. We're in with a chance here. So, of course, you know, I was up through the night, and at about 4:10, I gave a speech on the South Bank.
A new dawn! A new dawn! An independent United Kingdom! Amen!
4 hours later, the Prime Minister is gone.
I'm very proud and very honoured to have been Prime Minister of this country for 6 years. But the British people have made a very clear decision to take a different path. And as such, I think the country requires fresh leadership to take it in this direction.
It was a huge moment. The funny thing was, Boris Johnson and Michael Gove didn't wait for the result, they went to bed. When they woke up the next morning and left their front doors, they didn't look joyous, they looked flustered, as if, oh God, what have we done? They never really wanted to win. They never really wanted to win.
Whilst Cameron is resigning, Boris is at home with one of his closest advisers, Will Walden.
I remember watching him when Dave resigned, dressed in a Brazilian football shirt and ill-matching shorts. And he just was shaking his head. He was like, well, you know, what have we done? Poor Sam, it's dreadful. Look at that poor woman. I mean, having to go through this, you know, poor Dave. Totally Boris, totally mixed up, totally confused by, you know, what had been done, genuinely worried about the outcome. And then I think the crucial thing for him was what then happened as we left the house. We'd never had police at the house before. It was chaos. And I remember at that moment when Boris dived into the car, he looked pretty scared. These people, a lot of them young, they thought that Boris had stripped their future away. I remember zipping off in the car, and there's a light at the end of their road, and it was green. And I said, if it changes to orange, bust the light. I'll pay the ticket if you get it. I just said, just drive through it. It changed to orange, went to red, he slammed on the brakes. And I thought, oh, God. But I think at that moment he realised the effect of his part in the campaign. In Boris's mind, there was suddenly a kind of, what's the plan? We haven't got a plan. We never thought we were going to win.
Okay.
It's 11 a.m. and the country is looking to Boris and Michael Gove for what happens next.
And we ended up at Vote Leave. He wrote a speech which was pretty lacklustre, I think, by Boris's own standards, partly because they were shocked themselves.
Thank you very much. And I want to begin this morning by paying tribute to David Cameron, who has spoken earlier from Downing Street. I've known David Cameron for a very long time, and I believe he's been one of the most extraordinary politicians of our age.
The whole press conference didn't look prime ministerial. It didn't look like they were in charge. There was a reality and a dawning of kind of, who's going to do this? And with Cameron resigning, suddenly the plan was in Boris's hands. And I think for Boris, that changed everything from that moment.
Uniting a country divided by this referendum.
The pound and shares in British companies have already spiralled down. It is unprecedented stuff.
Within a day, news of Brexit wipes $2 trillion off the value of shares on the global stock market. And protests spring up across the country.
Are you taking control, Boris?
But Boris Johnson is now the favourite, and within touching distance of becoming Prime Minister.
You lost, but your boy won. How does that feel?
So it means it's a win-win situation. I had a text from him.
What does he say?
Just a second ago. Hey, hey, hey. Hope all well. Lots of love. I regard that as being a positive sign.
Would you like him to run?
I think I explained that he has to be a candidate. And I think it would be totally normal for a man who's made the effort he has made.
What's his name now?
To derail Europe. Sorry, I was a silly joke.
That's
a total joke. And not to be taken seriously.
Boris has dreamed of becoming Prime Minister for decades. The seeds of that ambition, some say, lie in Boris's relationship with his mother.
Boris clearly adores his mother. I think he quite modelled himself upon her, and I think they were rather similar. Quick, intelligent, humorous, and good-natured. I mean, his childhood wasn't easy. He witnessed quite a lot in some marital, you know, discord, which is not nice for any child. So naturally, she was worried about him, because she said to me that he was very vulnerable.
When Boris is 10 and living in Brussels, his childhood is thrown into disarray. His mother, Charlotte, leaves suddenly for London. She has been admitted to a psychiatric hospital after suffering a nervous breakdown.
She is a painter. And she did some horrendous pictures there. A lot of pictures of her children. There was always a slight undertone of darkness in her pictures. Here's a picture of them with tears all over the place.
When I was in hospital, they were very close to each other and very protective of each other. And Boris was always very protective of the younger children.
As a boy, Boris would tell people that one day he wanted to be world king.
I often thought that his being world king was a wish to make himself unhurtable, invincible, somehow safe from the pains of life, the pains of your mother disappearing for 8 months, the pains of your parents splitting up.
And I think that's what ultimately drove him into politics. It wasn't about some political mission or big ideological idea. It was about power in order to protect himself.
Mr. Johnson, any message of reassurance for the country? There are millions of very scared voters at the moment who are just looking for a message from their leader.
Now within grasp of realising his childhood dream, Boris has just 4 days to gather enough support from MPs.
None of these countries can handle the uncertainty, can they?
Hello, very nice to see you.
To run his campaign, yet again, he chooses Michael Gove.
See you later.
They'd all been summoned to Boris's house in the countryside to go and have kind of top-level talks about what was going to be happening next. And they sort of arrived to a sort of bacchanalian scene. There was a sort of barbecue and there was red wine and lots of drinking and partying. And, you know, Michael felt, we're not celebrating here. You know, this is a really serious thing that's happened. This is not a time to have a party. And Boris's response was, hooray, I've won a thing. And so Michael went sort of full Presbyterian Scot and Boris went sort of full Bullingdon.
Boris returns to London to secure votes.
Are you well? Good night, good day.
Take care, bye bye.
We look forward to the comments tomorrow.
See you.
Leadership too, though, yes?
Convinced he has enough support to win, Boris is ready to launch his campaign.
They'd come back from this party and Michael just was ashen-faced. He just walked in through the door. He said, I just don't think Boris is up to this. I just don't think he's up to it. But that was what threw Michael and made him think whether or not Boris was going to be able to take the job seriously enough.
I remember that I was travelling on the tube to go and get Boris to do the campaign launch. And I had a text on my phone appeared from one of Boris's senior aides, and it just said, effing Gove.
Bit of a dig at the Eton-educated Boris Johnson from the state school-educated Home Secretary.
Tom, I'm really sorry to interrupt. We're just hearing that Michael Gove is preparing to announce his candidacy as well.
I got off the tube, rang Boris, who'd been in the shower, apparently, when Gove had tried to call him, got to the house, and Boris was utterly crestfallen. He could not believe that this had happened after all they'd shared on the referendum campaign. He basically just kept shaking his head, just going, why? And then there was the whole point that we had to get in the campaign headquarters to decide what he was going to do.
Mr. Johnson, what's your message to Michael Gove? What's your message to Michael Gove?
Don't move out of the way, please.
Will this harm your campaign, Mr. Johnson?
Move out of the way.
Please hold your hand back, Mr. Johnson. What's your message to Michael Gove?
Can I get my wife?
Boris, are you fit to be Prime Minister?
Sorry, John. Thank you, sir.
You're not fit to run a bar!
Thank you.
Sir, this way, please. Your message to Michael Gove, Mr. Johnson.
Good morning, everybody.
Have a great day, everybody. Have a good one.
Nice to see you.
Jesus Christ.
We've got some news coming through to you. The Justice Secretary, Michael Gove, will stand for the Conservative leadership and the Prime Ministership.
I stand here, and I'm standing for the leadership, not as a result of calculation. Certainly not as a result of calculation. I'm standing because I have a burning desire to transform our country.
Your assassination of Boris Johnson, if I could put it that way, has cost you quite a lot of kindness and respect among your colleagues. You'll know that. Can you possibly recover from that?
If you're the sort of person who worries about personal criticism, if you're the sort of person who allows the attacks from others to get under your skin, you shouldn't be leader.
Wow. I mean, I'm still picking my jaw up off the ground.
This is Michael Gove plunging a dagger into the back, front, side, head of Boris Johnson, raising basically questions about his character, his credibility, but the really damaging part of this is he may well have kiboshed Boris Johnson's leadership ambitions.
Boris, has Michael Gove betrayed you?
No.
Has Michael Gove, your friend, let you down? He says he doesn't trust you.
Come on, let's have it.
Now, Boris has a big decision to make. Should he still run to be Prime Minister and risk losing?
What do you make of Michael Gove's intervention?
I'm here to back Boris. I'm not talking about any other candidates.
Or step down and wait for a better moment. The problem with that is it would be letting down all the MPs who have publicly backed him, betting their careers on his success.
Immediately, you just go into the mode of kind of, how are we going to do this? Is he going to stand? There was an argument that, you know, Boris was the great campaigner. He could turn this around. The truth is he'd lost 60 MPs. I think it was going to be very difficult for him to win.
I was the first MP ever to write a public article saying that he was our witty winner. I wrote that in 2012. It's blindingly obvious. Even then, this person is going to be the next Prime Minister.
Thank you very much. Thank you, everyone. Thank you very much, everybody. Thank you very much, everybody, for coming along this morning. Great to see so many people here. It is vital now to see this moment for what it is. It is not a crisis. This is not a time for wobbling or self-doubt, but as a moment for hope and ambition for Britain.
Suddenly, I realised that there was a point in the speech, and I was thinking, hang on, he'd just written the speech before he went in, but I'd seen an earlier draft. And I said, oh, you're not supposed to be saying that.
That is the agenda for the next Prime Minister of this country. But I must tell you, my friends, you who have waited faithfully for the punchline of this speech, I have concluded that person cannot be me. Thank you all very much. Thank you.
Boris, you feel betrayed?
Take care, everybody.
Have a great day.
Wet
breathing.
I'm here.
I got in the car with him and we headed to the home in Islington. And within 15 minutes of that journey, he looked at me and he said, I made the wrong decision. Should never have backed out.
In July 2016, Theresa May becomes Prime Minister, and Boris is out in the cold.
Do we have a plan for Brexit? We do. Are we ready for the effort it will take? We are. Can Boris Johnson stay on message for a full 4 days?
Boris is an incredibly competitive person. I remember his sister Rachel telling me a story that when I think she was 4 and Boris was 5, it was her birthday party and she got up on the table to make a speech. Boris became so incensed that she was momentarily the centre of attention that he leapt up on the table and threw her off the table and started making a speech himself. You know, absolute yearning for the spotlight.
In this tricky new world for Boris, he's waiting to know what boat he'll be in. Will she let him stew on the back benches? Or give him a job in the cabinet?
I can remember sitting with Boris here in Parliament. I said, what are you doing, mate? And he said, well, I'm Googling government departments to find out which departments have a bigger budget than London. Because if I got offered a job, I wouldn't want to take a job where there was less responsibility than being mayor of London. And while I was there, the phone rang, and it was Theresa May.
I think his view was he was going to be kind of minister for paperclips, if anything, and should he accept that job. But I think he didn't expect what then happened. I think he might have rung, and he was just like, I'm the effing foreign secretary.
Theresa May has shocked the world by appointing Boris Johnson as her foreign secretary.
He's not exactly seen as a safe pair of hands. He's entertaining, but hardly diplomatic.
Foreign secretary has just been announced as Boris Johnson.
World leaders thought he was a buffoon. The State Department official brief, he laughed because he didn't think it was true. But he's nothing if not the great survivor, and he just thought, well, I'm going to prove them wrong.
Wait there.
Boris will be working with Sir Simon Macdonald, the Foreign Office's most experienced diplomat.
He was clearly a different sort of politician. He was more relaxed, he was very confident, and he was more quirky. And so a big personality means the possibility of big surprises. And I didn't know what they would be, but I had worked out that professional life would be interesting.
Foreign Secretary, 4 months ago, you wrote a poem that described the president of Turkey as a wankerer. Are you going to apologize?
You've accused the current US President Barack Obama of harboring a part Kenyan's, quote, ancestral dislike for the British Empire. You've described a possible future US President Hillary Clinton as someone with, quote, dyed blonde hair and pouty lips and a steely blue stare, like a sadistic nurse in a mental hospital, unquote.
There is such a rich thesaurus now of things that I've said that it would really take me too long to engage in a full global itinerary of apology to all concerned.
Our ambassador to the EU in Brussels had the privilege of going to Oxford with Boris, and he told me that this man is a very smart and capable man. That's the Boris Johnson
I can live with that.
I have met, and we intend to make good things happen together.
Stop that. That's fine. That's great. Thank you.
It's called diplomacy.
That's fantastic. It's going well. It's going well, John. Thank you very much. Phew.
One of the things that people knew about Boris Johnson was that he had ripe opinions about foreigners. So this was something we had to consider because it was possible that those groups would take offence. And I remember very early on discussing this. And what I suggested to him was that all of that had been in the past. He'd been a journalist, he'd been interested in selling copy, and he looked at me and he said, Simon, yes. That's a good idea. And if we were talking about anyone else, that would be a reasonable idea. But we're talking about me, and I won't change.
Boris's approach has consequences. He wrongly describes the work of Nazanin Zaghari Ratcliffe, a British-Iranian political prisoner, and jeopardizes her release.
The Iranian state TV have welcomed your comments about Nazneen as an unintended confession. What do you say to that? Do you have any comments about that?
And when he visits Burma, where a genocide is taking place, he casually starts quoting Kipling and overshadows the diplomatic mission.
Come you back, read the new English song. You never left.
Probably not. What, the rich man lay?
Yeah.
There's a sense that Boris isn't taking the job seriously enough.
What do you think, Andrew?
Well, this is a great mystery about who did it. Nobody seems to have seen it happen.
Well, they've had three tours this week, so they're probably over on us as for mine, isn't
it? Anyway, it's absolutely tragic.
Boris's view of being foreign secretary was that he was put in an expensive cigar tube flown around the world and kept out of touch with British politics for a couple of years. It was a very clever tactical move by Theresa May.
Are you running away from the big decisions again, Boris?
Mr. Johnson, do you think the Prime Minister can deliver a Brexit deal?
A few minutes ago, Downing Street put out this statement. This afternoon, the Prime Minister accepted the resignation of Boris Johnson as Foreign Secretary. The Prime Minister thanked Boris for his work. Well, a pretty short and curt statement there from Number 10.
Frustrated with Theresa May's Brexit negotiations and his own political ambitions being thwarted, Boris shocks the world by quitting, throwing May's government into turmoil.
Who's running the country, Prime Minister?
Boris is out of the cabinet and returns to the back benches to strategize his next move.
The Johnson I knew at The Spectator started out as a sort of liberal cosmopolitan figure and found that political space kept on opening up for him to the right. The same thing was happening across the Atlantic with Trump. Populism, a new breed of authoritarian, populist, right-wing leaders. There were votes to be found in taking far-right positions. This is all calculated, I should think. He knows it goes down very well amongst Tory activists.
They look like letterboxes, Boris Johnson wrote on Monday. He even compared women who wear them to bank robbers, though he insisted that unlike some states, Britain shouldn't ban the burqa.
Dominating everything today is, of course, the Boris burqa row. The Guardian, front page, Johnson should apologise for offensive burqa remark. The Times, May calls on Johnson to apologise for burqa letterbox remark. The Mirror, spineless.
Boris Johnson is probably sitting at home with a glass of whiskey, well, watching this, quite happy that he's being talked about.
Man, Boris, what happened to freedom of speech?
You know, he's actually done this because he wants to get elected. This is what he's done to pander to the extreme right of the party.
Racist remarks, Mr. Speaker, which have led to a spike in hate crime.
Mr. Johnson, would you apologise for what your comments?
Will you have a cup of tea?
Will you apologise for your comments?
Would you like a cup of tea?
If I have a cup of tea, will you answer my question?
No, I'm here solely on a humanitarian mission because you've been here all day and you've been incredibly patient and incredibly, and I feel very sorry for you, because I have nothing to say about this matter except to offer you some tea.
Okay.
Go on.
Okay, thank you. Thank you so much.
Go on. Let me see if you can bring it back.
Right, thank you.
No worries.
Take care. That's it, okay?
People say, oh, politicians should be careful what they say and they should watch their words and all this sort of mumbo-jumbo. I don't agree. I really don't.
Even if it's offensive?
I think one of the reasons...
Even if it's offensive, Mr. Johnson?
I don't want to cause offence if I can possibly avoid it.
Well, then don't refer to them as bank robbers.
You know, I think...
You just said you would again.
I think that one of the duties of a politician is to speak his mind or her mind insofar as possible.
You need to push back.
I've got the world on a string, sitting on a rainbow. Got the string around my finger.
It's been 2.5 years since Boris withdrew from the race to become leader of the Conservative Party. Now, with new support from right-wing MPs, and with Theresa May coming under increasing scrutiny, Boris starts to position himself as the next Prime Minister. Beautiful thing. As long as I hold the string, I'd be a silly so-and-so if I should ever let it go. I got the world on a string, sitting on a rainbow. Almost a year since he resigned from her government, Boris helps topple Theresa May.
I will shortly leave the job that it has been the honour of my life to hold, with enormous and enduring gratitude to have had the opportunity to serve the country I love.
In the next hour, we'll find out who's won the race to become the new leader of the Conservative Party and the UK's next Prime Minister.
It's July 2019. And the UK waits to discover the identity of its new Prime Minister.
Bollocks to Boris! You are not fit to govern! And there is no way you should be Prime Minister!
This time, Boris is up against Jeremy Hunt.
Stanley, can I just ask you, which one of your sons are we going to get as Prime Minister? People in burqas look like letterboxes, or the open London mayor that people saw years ago?
Now, team.
Don't want to answer that.
Isn't it lunchtime? Isn't it getting on for lunchtime? That's what I was thinking.
What would make you proud as a father? What kind of Boris would you like to see?
I'm very proud. That's fine by me. I'll stick with what I've got. I'm really, really fine. Totally proud. How do you have any optimism?
Despite Stanley's show of public support, the Johnson family remains divided. Rachel has quit the Conservative Party. And Boris's brother, Joe, has been campaigning in favour of a second referendum.
It's a proud thing to be given the office of Prime Minister of Britain. As for courage, character, I know the British people have these in full measure.
I have only one thing to say. You turn if you want to.
Some people say where the pound shop trumps. But I don't like the politics of what's going on. Sort of every day is like a sort of schizophrenic nightmare. But I care about him as a sibling.
Of course there are tensions in any family, and their relationships must be quite tortured. They disagree over quite a lot. And in some ways, the psychodrama within the Johnson clan is a reflection of the wider psychodrama within the country. So Brexit versus Remain, chaos versus order. They're a mirror up to society in a way.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Jeremy Hunt and Boris Johnson.
Dame Cheryl Gillan, declare that the total number of votes given to each candidate was as follows. Jeremy Hunt, 46,656. Boris Johnson, 92,153. And therefore I give notice that Boris Johnson is elected as the leader of the Conservative and Unionist Party.
At last, Boris has achieved his dream. He is leader of the Conservative Party and Prime Minister of the United Kingdom.
Thank you very much. Well, thank you very much. Good morning, everybody. Thank you. Thank you, everybody. I want to thank all of you, obviously, for the extraordinary honour and privilege that you have just conferred on me. And I know that there will be people around the place who will question the wisdom of your decision. I say to all the doubters, dude, we are going to energise the country. We're going to get Brexit done on October the 31st. We're going to take advantage of all the opportunities that it will bring in a new spirit of can-do. I will work flat out from now on to repay your confidence, but in the meantime, the campaign is over and the work begins. Thank you all very much.
He was about 4 years old. He was asked, what would you like to be when you grew up? And he said, world king. He's not a good loser, you know? That's why he's won. Because the spoils go to the person who wants them most.
And the series continues next Wednesday at 9, or you can stream the whole thing right now. And vying for position tomorrow evening at 8:30 with the best of the action from under the lights in Jeddah, with highlights of the Saudi Grand Prix qualifying. Verstappen already the one to catch. Well, back to tonight, and the Gogglebox are watching an interview with Rishi Sunak next.